Okay, I'm proud to introduce Professor Nikolai Rasmussen, the fourth of the 1997 climate lectures, and he'll be talking on finite dimensional representations of quantum and finite algebras.
Thank you. Okay, so this is the title of today's lecture. And first, let me introduce, so I'll slowly sort of come to the point of this lecture, but first I'll have to introduce quite a bit of notions. So most of these notions will be familiar. So let me start from the very beginning. By quantum affine algebra, I mean it's a short abbreviation for quantized universal enveloping algebra of affinely algebra. Now, affinely algebras or affine cosmoidy algebras, these are essentially the following. These are central extensions of loop algebras for simple Lie algebras. So let G be a complex simple Lie algebra. And let LG be polynomial loops, so maps from S1 to G, and we consider S1 as the unit circle in the complex plane, and we consider by these polynomial loops, I mean polynomial maps from complex plane, from the complex unit circle to G. Or you can also think about this polynomial loop algebra as following formal Laurent polynomials in formal variable T with coefficients in the Lie algebra G. And this space has natural Lie bracket, the Lie bracket of two monomials. This is just the Lie bracket of X and Y, and the degree adds. So this Lie algebra has a natural two-cycle, which sort of analytically is the, I mean, which is simply the residue of the following. You take a Killing form. So here, this brackets means the mean the Killing form for G, and you consider the central extension of the loop algebra by this two-cycle C. So in this case, if K is the generator of this central extension, we will have this exact sequence. So the explicitly for images of monomials in this central extension, and here by xn, I simply mean x t to the n. So this is an element of the central extension which corresponds to this monomial. So explicitly, in terms of these elements, the Lie bracket in the central extension is this one. You take this part is the Lie bracket in the loop algebra, and this K is the generator of the central extension. And K bracket with any element is zero. It's a central. So this is the sort of geometrical description of the loop algebra and of the of affine Lie algebras. And algebraical description, in order to give algebraic description in terms of cosmoidy algebras, let me first remind the theorem by Serre about generating of simple Lie algebra G by SL2 triples corresponding to simple roots. So the theorem is the following, that if G is a simple Lie algebra, then it is generated by these 3n elements EI, HI, FI with the following determining relations. Here matrix AIJ is the Cartan matrix of the Lie algebra, of the simple Lie algebra G. So there is a similar description for the this central extension of polynomial loops. For this, let's consider the following notations. Let E alpha and EF alpha be root elements for this simple Lie algebra G. Say alpha are positive roots. And then these elements HI, which generate the Cartan subalgebra, E alpha and F alpha, all these elements, they form linear bases for the Lie algebra G. And we can define the following elements in G hat. So this is F theta T E0, H0 is the central extension minus H theta, and F0 is E theta times T minus 1, this monomial. Here theta is the maximal root of G, the root of the longest, well, the maximal root of G. So H theta is, I mean, it's a linear combination of simple roots with non-negative coefficients, and this H theta is just the combination of the generators HI with the same coefficients. So consider these elements, and then there is the following nice characterization of affine Lie algebra, not via this description as a central extension of polynomial loops, but algebraic in terms of generators and relations. So statement number one, these elements E, H, and F, they satisfy the relations which are very similar to the relations describing simple Lie algebra. And in fact, both of them are examples of Kac-Moody algebras. And this is almost Kac-Moody algebra. So the relations are the following. H computes, and then you can compute these relations, in fact, from the definition of E0, H0, and F0. And you can do this simple exercise. This matrix A hat is called affine Cartan matrix of this affine Lie algebra G hat, and it's n plus 1 times n plus 1 matrix. You have one more root, imaginary root alpha 0, and to this root we have corresponding generators E0, H0, F0, and so the Cartan matrix is n plus 1 times n plus 1 matrix. It contains the finite dimensional Cartan matrix as a submatrix with the appropriate normalization of the Killing form. This element will be equal to 2, and then you can compute these elements via the scalar products sort of this longest root theta and simple roots alpha I. So this is a nice exercise to compute these brackets, to compute all these Cartan matrices. So then the second, this is a trivial part. And then the non-trivial part is that these relations are in fact determining for the affine Lie algebra G hat. And this theorem is due to Gadber and Katz. And here, remark. Last time I gave a definition of Kac-Moody algebra corresponding to generalized Cartan matrix A. So G hat is not a Kac-Moody algebra, but it will be a Kac-Moody algebra if you will consider the extension of G hat by the derivation element D. This will be something which last time I would denote G A hat. This is the Kac-Moody algebra. And this element D, it's a derivation of the, it's the element whose bracket always the elements from G hat is the derivation of G hat, and it has these brackets. With it commutes with Cartan, and then its bracket with EI will be delta I zero EI, and its bracket with FI will be minus delta I zero FI. So there is this nice picture sort of for for affine Lie algebras. You can either describe them as central extensions, or you can describe them in terms just purely algebraically in these terms. And both of these descriptions are useful for different purposes, but they are both useful. So let's first look at the finite dimensional representations of affine Lie algebras. So they all look they all can be constructed from so-called evaluation representations. And there is nothing more simple than evaluation representation. For this, you just have to pick up some finite dimensional G module, where G is the underlying simple algebra. And you have to also pick up some non-zero complex number. And then the evaluation representation pi z is the homomorphism from the from the Lie algebra G to the Lie algebra of endomorphisms of V, with the commutator bracket, which maps the element xn, this formal monomial, essentially xt to the n, to pi x z to the n. And all these representations have zero value of the central extension. So they are essentially representations of the loop algebras. And again, it's the simplest representation of the loop algebra. You simply evaluate this formal variable t to some fixed complex number. And what? Well, you see, element d is not in g hat. There are no evaluation representations of Kasmoudi algebras. I mean, you have to glue them all together. So then you can act on it by Z. So, well, there is this nice theorem. I think it's due to Cherry and Presley, and they did it in somewhere around 86. So every irreducible finite dimensional G hat module or module over loop algebra is isomorphic to tensor product of evaluation representations. So this completely solves the question about irreducible finite dimensional representations of loop algebras. Now there's another very interesting class of representations, so-called highest weight representations of loop algebras and of affine Lie algebras and of Kasmoudi algebras. It's the easiest way to characterize these representations is in terms of this Kasmoudi generators EI, HI, FI. So these are the modules that are generated by G hat action on the highest weight, and the highest weight is the is the vector which is vanished by the action of positive sort of generators EI. Cartan acts diagonally on this vector, and this lambda is called highest weight of this vector, and K acts as some complex number which is called level of representation. And of course, since K is central, it acts as the scalar number on every vector of the module. So one of the reasons why this highest weight modules are important is because they sort of give the idea of why the following completion of the universal enveloping algebra of the affine Lie algebra is natural. Consider infinite sums, sum over n1 plus nk equals to n capital is fixed, and this and I are integers. And you can multiply these monomials to every non-negative powers of these integers n1. So if you think, if you look at this, if these sums, they actually act on the highest weight modules. The reason is the following.
So what do those colons represent? Those double dots?
Oh, these double dots means the following, that you move all monomials with negative n to the left and all monomials with positive n to the right, so-called normal ordering. So in general, this is an infinite sum, but sort of the remarkable property of these infinite sums is that on the highest weight modules, they act as finite sums, because most of these elements act by zero on every given vector of the highest weight module, in particular on the highest weight module.
And that factor n1 to the alpha 1, does that multiply?
Yes, so just you take this monomial, take its normal ordering, so you move all elements with negative n to the left, all elements with positive n to the right, and then you multiply to this factor and take sum over all n, who sums up to n capital.
The alphas are fixed, or?
Alphas are any non-negative integers. Fixed, yeah. So if you add them to the universal enveloping algebra, so this completion is usually called the local completion of the universal enveloping algebra of the algebra G hat. Now it has nice meaning.
If the alphas are fixed, are they, what are these alphas? Are they,
well, let me explain the meaning of this. I mean, this is a formal sort of description. Now the meaning is the following. Consider the following generating functions. Sum over n, x, well, this is nothing. Just for any x, consider this generating function. Z to the minus n. Then, essentially, these sums are Fourier coefficients of the following monomials. Take the normal ordering of, say, derivative in with respect to z, so this dz is simply derivative with respect to z. dz alpha 1 x 1 z z z alpha k x k z. So this is a power series, formal power series in z. And this symbol means that every coefficient of this formal power series should be normally ordered. And coefficients of this power series will be finite sums of monomials like this. So essentially what happens is that we add to the universal enveloping algebra all components of this formal power series. It's a very natural definition in terms of, I mean, this definition essentially came from quantum field theory, and this is where this normal ordering notion came from. So essentially the idea is that without this completion, universal enveloping algebra is too small. There is nothing interesting going on there. In particular, it is what I said, nothing interesting is going on, is reflected in this theorem. Say, for the local completion of the universal enveloping algebra of G hat at level k, and this, well, I think I'll just write it here. So I introduced this notion, this notation, local completion at level k, which is simply the quotient of this. Here k is a complex number, quotient over the ideal generated by this. K is a generator and k is this complex number. I localize this generator of the center at this complex number. So the statement is the following. If k is not equal to the dual Coxeter number, so h dual is the dual Coxeter number for G. And it has very simple, there is a very simple formula for this number. It's equal to this. You take the Killing form, properly normalized, and compute this scalar product, where theta is the maximal root. And it has lots of other meanings, but this is the numerical value of this number. So first statement is that the center of this algebra for generic level is simply the center of the universal enveloping algebra. But at the critical level, this center is infinite dimensional. And it's infinite dimensional even here, but it's infinitely generated. It's sort of, roughly speaking, it looks like n functions of z, where n is the rank of the corresponding Lie algebra. And here is a remark. So if you will not take the local completion, if you'll just take the universal enveloping algebra of G hat at generic level, at any level, then the center of this will be isomorphic to the center of the corresponding simple Lie algebra. And here I give an example of a central element, an example of generating function for central elements. Consider EA, orthonormal basis in G, and let's form again this generating function, which I was already talking about. This will be sum over all integers, E A N, the corresponding generators of G hat, Z to the minus N minus 1. For some reasons, it's important to keep this minus 1. And consider the element, which is equal to sum over A. There is a long history behind this element. It's called Virasoro element, or it's also called Sugawara element, and it also looks like the Casimir, sort of local Casimir operator. If you wouldn't have central extension, this obviously would be in the center. So this is, now we write it as following, sum over n ln z to the minus n minus 2. And the theorem which I sort of essentially meant here in the last sentence on this page is that ln is in the center of u g hat local completion at the level k. Now, if you wouldn't put normal ordering here, this would be pointwise Casimir element. So there's sort of nothing terribly surprising that this element generated some central element in this algebra. But it's important that I put here the normal ordering. So it's not just pointwise Casimir anymore. That's only for, yes. That's only for critical level, only for these special values of the center. So now the question, which was answered a few years ago by Fagin and Frankel, the question was, what is the center? How to describe this infinite dimensional algebra? And if it wouldn't have some extra remarkable structure, the description of this algebra wouldn't be probably so nice. Fortunately, it has a Poisson algebra structure. So we can use these tools of Poisson geometry and Poisson algebras in this problem. Maybe I'll leave it here. So some general statements. Suppose that we have a family of algebras parameterized by some by elements of some interval I, and assume that it's a sort of flat family of algebras, so that all these vector spaces are isomorphic. Let's choose these isomorphisms and let's identify all these spaces. And let's fix some point at this interval, H0. And at the center of the associative algebra AH0, let's define the following bracket. This is just the limit as H goes to H0 of the commutator of A and B divided over H minus H0. And the commutator is taken not in AH0, but in AH, in the sort of so it's a very natural definition. You take a commutator in AH, and then you take the limits as H goes to H0, and if you know that the images will belong to the center, then this commutator will vanish at least in order 1. So this definition makes sense, at least. It may give 0, but that's a sort of different story. So there's always this Poisson structure. Now it has the following. So now here's the theorem. I mean, there's always this bracket. And here's the theorem about this bracket. It is so center of the algebra H0 with this bracket is a Poisson algebra. This follows immediately from the property of commutators in AH and from the fact that it's a central algebra. And this is the center. So second property is the following. This, in the definition of Poisson bracket, I choose specific identification of the algebras in this family. However, it's not important, as this statement 2 says. This Poisson bracket doesn't really depend on the identification. If you will choose another identification, which will be different from this one, say, such that it will be, which will be different in higher orders of H minus H0, it will give the same Poisson bracket. So this is an invariant notion which is defined for this fixed value of H0. And then finally, third property is the following, that you see, we have these algebras isomorphic as vector spaces. Now, if it happens that there is such an isomorphism between these vector spaces that the centers are isomorphic, and the centers are commutative algebras, so the isomorphism of the vector spaces will give the isomorphism of commutative algebras, then the Poisson bracket is zero. So the only one case when this Poisson bracket will give something non-trivial, when there is a jump deformation of the center, when at some point the sort of the size of the center jumps. And well, let's look for the let's look here at our center of the local completion of the universal enveloping algebra of the affinely algebra. It's this finitely generated commutative algebra for all values except this minus dual Coxeter number, except the critical value. And at the critical value, it jumps and becomes infinitely generated. So naturally, we expect some non-trivial Poisson structure on this huge center. And there is a nice description of this Poisson algebra. So now the question is how to describe the Poisson algebra, which is the center of the local completion of this universal Hamiltonian algebra at the critical level. Here is the description. Can be given in terms of so-called Drinfeld-Sokolov reduction. In terms of the certain Hamiltonian reduction related to the Hamiltonian actions of certain groups. So this is a Poisson algebra, and we want to describe it as a Poisson algebra. So here is the description of this algebra. Well, let me first introduce a few notions again. So let's denote by GL the Langlands dual to G. This is a very simple notion. So GL simply has the root lattice, which is dual to the root lattice of G. So for all simple Lie algebras except B and C, Langlands dual is the same as the Lie algebra itself. And this notion just switches B and C type between themselves. So now this is the first notion. Second notion is the following. Consider the space which is dual to this Lie algebra G hat. Now this dual vector space, so G hat is the central extension of the loop algebra. So loop algebra acts by the adjoint action on the loop algebra itself. So it acts on the, so what I'm saying is that if you consider this dual vector space together with the coadjoint action of the loop group on it, then you can identify this space with the space of connections, and the action of the loop group will be simply the gauge action on the space of connections. So as a set, of course, this G hat dual is simply as a vector space, is simply generated by Fourier components of some function of formal variable T with values in G star and by one-dimensional complex vector space corresponding to this derivation. But geometrically, if you consider the action of the loop group, sort of coadjoint action, then it has this nice interpretation. Elements of G hat star are connections, and the coadjoint action is just the gauge action.
Connections in what? Is there
a... you consider the G star bundle, so bundle over S1. So now consider the following. Consider the subspace in the dual space to the finite dimensional Lie algebra consisting from those elements. So here, essentially this, say for SLN, and this is the, presumably, probably the best way to think about it. For SLN, this space is the following. It consists from matrices that have zeros here, then on the next lower off diagonal, they have ones, they have something on the diagonal, and they have something in the upper part. Let's denote this subspace by M. Yes. Well, with the proper identification of G hat and G hat star. It's in G star. Oh yeah, oh, I'm sorry, yes, this is just... Difficult there. So the theorem, which describes the center, as a Poisson algebra. First statement of this theorem is the following, that the gauge action of the loop group LG on this space of connections descends to the action of the loops in the upper unipotent group. So U is this, it's a subgroup in G. So I assume that, say, G is a simple complex algebraic group with the Lie algebra G. And U is the subgroup of upper unipotent matrices in G. So it descends to the action of the of this loop group on the loops in this space M. In other words, on functions of Z, of matrix valued functions of this form.
What is the data star?
Well, just a bunch of functions. F11.
M is contained in G star?
G star is the vector space dual to G.
Okay.
No, this is G. So then the statement is the following, that the center is the following. It's a functions on loops in M that are invariant with respect to the gauge action of loops in U. And the Poisson structure on this, or in other words, you can consider this as functions on reduced space. And Poisson structure is given by the corresponding moment map. So this is the theorem, I think it's the theorem by Fagan and Frankel. So they gave this nice description for the center of the completed universal enveloping algebra. And I just want to emphasize that here it's not G, it's G Langlands dual. So you take the center of the of this universal enveloping algebra for the Langlands dual algebra. And then you do this, all this construction for G. And this is how it works. So this geometric construction for G is equal to the algebraic construction for G dual. So this is the case, how much time do I have?
Started about
10 minutes late, so about 20-25 minutes. Okay, great. Can I borrow you? Yes, there is a canonical Poisson structure on G star, the Kirilov-Costant Poisson structure, and then the action of a loop group is Hamiltonian. So the action of this subgroup is Hamiltonian too. And from here you get the moment map. So this is... Did I answer the question?
Well, I was asking how the moment map gives the Poisson structure, but that's not quite what you were saying. You were just saying that there is a moment map.
Yes. It's a Poisson version of symplectic reduction. It's not quite. Yeah. One can think about this in two ways. If you think about this as a Poisson algebra, it's just enough to say that these are gauge invariant functions.
Right.
I mean, in terms of this moment map, you would have to sort of more carefully describe the reduced space. So far this had nothing to do with quantum groups. And so far the important point was that the center was equal to this space of gauge invariant functions. Now let me draw the analogy with the famous Harishchandra theorem. Say, Harishchandra theorem says the following. One of his theorem says the following. The center of the universal enveloping algebra of finite dimensional Lie algebra, simple Lie algebra G, is the same as the space of W invariant polynomials on the dual space to the Cartan algebra. And he constructed explicitly this isomorphism. So here we have W invariant polynomials on H star. You can think about this theorem as some kind of functional analog of the Harishchandra description of the center. Here, so the gauge group, the action of the gauge group here, sort of morally, you can think about this as an infinite dimensional Weyl group. I mean, I'm exaggerating slightly here, but this is how you can sort of think about this theorem. And I could have been more precise, but this is sort of the moral meaning of this theorem.
There is no Poisson structure
on this. Yes, there is no Poisson structure on this, but this is, well, roughly speaking, that's the reason why you have here a gauge action of some Lie group, and here you have the action of some discrete group. So, I mean, there is a Poisson structure here, it's just zero. It's a very unfortunate Poisson structure. So, so now let me say about another moral analog of this Harishchandra isomorphism, but now not for infinite dimensional Lie algebras, but for finite dimensional quantum groups. And then finally, in the end, we will come to infinite dimensional quantum group, and we will have the moral analog of this isomorphism for the infinite dimensional quantum groups. So now let's turn attention to the quantized universal enveloping algebras of simple Lie algebras. So I introduced all these notions in the last lecture. So UQG is a quasi-triangular Hopf algebra in the appropriate sense. Topological sense, and I don't want to be more precise here, otherwise this would take one or two lectures. So the moral meaning of this is the following, that there is an element R in the appropriate completion or in the appropriate object which would replace this tensor squared of the algebra, such that the opposite co-multiplication and the direct co-multiplication, they are conjugated by this element R, so it's invertible element, and the action of the co-multiplication on this element R is given by these formulas. And I use the same notations R12, R13, R23 as I used last time. So again, the moral meaning of this definition is the following, that the category of modules is an abelian category with this extra structure. It's a rigid braided monoidal category. Rigid means it has duals. The braided, it has means that there is this canonical commutator, functorial isomorphisms between V tensor W and W tensor V for every pair of finite dimensional representations. And monoidal means that there is a tensor product which is associative. Now, consider the following elements. ZV, which is the following. We have element R in UQG squared. I'll not pay attention to this details about completions because for this particular reason then irrelevant. So ZV is equal to trace V tensor identity, and you apply this to the R sigma R. Sigma is the permutation in the tensor product of two copies of the universal enveloping algebra. Now trace V of an element A is the following. It's the matrix trace over this vector space V of the following element. You take element Q to the H rho. And this is the Cartan element of the quantized algebra corresponding to the sum of, or half of the sum of all positive roots. And then you take it to compose it with the element A acting in this representation. This is something which is called quantum trace. It is not a cyclic functional, but it's sort of twisted cyclic functional by the antipod. It has this cyclic property. Trace of AB is equal to trace of B S squared A, where S squared is the square of the antipod. There is this very important automorphism. So this is what I was writing here. And now these are remarkable elements. They give this, you can think about these elements ZV. You can think about the collection of these elements ZV as a map from finite dimensional, more precisely from the isomorphism classes of finite dimensional representations to U, Q, G. So it associates with V, an element ZV, and then the statement here is that this element depends actually only on the isomorphism class of this representation, not on the representation itself. So in particular, if you parameterize irreducible representations by highest weights, there will be each representative. For each class, there will be one representative, which is the highest weight module. So this would be the just collection of elements depending on the highest weight. And the theorem about these elements is the following. First statement. These elements are in the center of the quantized universal enveloping algebra. So second statement is the following, that the center of this quantized universal enveloping algebra is the direct sum over all isomorphism classes of irreducible representations V of the one-dimensional spaces generated by these elements. In other words, if you will take all elements ZV corresponding to irreducible representations V, you will have a linear basis in the center. And finally, just explicit description of these elements V. If V lambda, V mu are two finite dimensional modules with the highest weights lambda and mu, then if you will compute this central element ZV lambda on the irreducible representation V mu, you will get a number which is the following. It's a character of the corresponding group G computed on this element of the Cartan algebra, Q to the power rho plus mu. So these are very special numbers. And finally, the... So... rho is the half of the sum of positive roots. It came from here, from the definition of the metric trace. So here's some extra properties of this Z. If you will take Z corresponding to the tensor product, you will get the product of Z's. If you have exact sequence, short exact sequence of modules, then the this alternated sum sort of the Euler characteristic of this will be zero. So in other words, what we really have here is the following. We have the isomorphism between two rings. A ring of finite dimensional representations. A ring of isomorphism classes of finite dimensional representations of UQG and the center of the algebra itself. So there is a remarkable... So here we just... So there is a remarkable duality. Now, you can... You, now, after this universal enveloping algebra was deformed, We have something much better than in the undeformed case. Now, this is the same as the ring of characters. Or the same as, I mean, this is the same words for the ring of isomorphism classes of finite dimensional representations. I mean, if it's just an algebra, then isomorphism classes form vector space. So if it's a bi-algebra, they form a ring because you can multiply representations tensorially, and this is the ring multiplication. So this is what happens in the finite dimensional case.
So what happens when Q goes to 1? How does the picture?
Well, then you will have to, well, you see the formula for the characters. When Q goes to 1, it becomes the dimension, the value of the character at the identity, plus higher order terms in H. And if you want to sort of identify these two statements, somehow you have to do the following. You have to identify this with this. And you can simply expand these characters in power series in H, and it will give you the identification. So this is the finite dimensional case.
You can go to the limit in the formula for Z, right?
No, you have to take linear combinations of this. I mean, strictly speaking, when you want to consider the limit Q goes to 1, then what you have to do is the following. In order to get these polynomials, you have to consider some alternating powers of. Basically, one has to say carefully what it would mean the following. You just expand this in H and take the coefficients of this. Coefficients of this will be double invariant functions, say, of mu. Double invariant functions of mu plus rho, more precisely. For the obvious reasons, because these are characters. Okay, now I still have 7 minutes.
Yeah.
So now quantum affine algebras. So let me clear this blackboard, and I'll just. So here we have the center of the universal developing algebra of G. Here we have the center of the local completion of this algebra, and it is isomorphic to the, well, certain Gaussian invariant functions. So now I'm going to talk about this. So now we'll. So last time I defined what is the quantized Kac-Moody algebra. In particular, this gives the definition of quantized affine Lie algebra. And this quantized affine Lie algebra is quasi-triangular, as I mentioned last time. And for finite dimensional of representations of UQG hat, Well, one can introduce again the notion of evaluation representation, comparing representations of UQG hat with representations of the undeformed algebra. And now let me list some problems here, because the situation with this algebra is much less clear than with this one. So here's the most interesting problem, which in some sense is still, I mean, there are lots of partial results, but I don't think that there is a complete answer to this question. So how to describe the category of finite dimensional modules over this algebra? They turned out to be much more complicated than just evaluation representations for the algebra G hat. So the more easy question, which will be answered at the end of this lecture, is describe the representation ring for fundamental representations. This algebra is not, say, if you take it at the level zero, it's not, it has reducible but indecomposable representations. It's not semi-simple anymore. So it is not enough to have the information about the representation ring in order to reconstruct the category of modules, because you may have representations for which this sequence is exact, but for which, say, you have this sub-representation, and this would be sub-quotient. But it's not necessary that from here it would follow that this one is sum of V1 and V3. And so the problem number two is easier. The third problem, the most interesting problem, sort of from the various numerological points of view, is the following. You have, well, we have the embedding of Hopf algebras. UQG is sitting inside of UQG hat, just in the same way as G sitting in G hat. And it's sitting as a Hopf subalgebra. So the most natural question here is to describe the multiplicities. You take an irreducible representation of UQG hat, restricted to UQG, and the result, I mean, finite dimensional representation, UQG is semi-simple, so you must expect the direct sum of irreducible representations with some multiplicities. So to find these multiplicities turns out to be quite non-trivial problem, still open in general, with some partial answers. Now, I should say one more important fact about these algebras. For usual loop algebras, you can do the following. You can take any representation of G, and you can lift it to the evaluation representation. Now, unfortunately, this is not longer true for UQG hat. You cannot just take any representation of UQG and lift it to the evaluation representation of this bigger algebra. There are some obstructions to this lifting. In fact, what happens is something like this. You take a representation V lambda of UQG, and you want to lift it to the representation, to finite dimensional representation of UQG hat. If you will try to do it, you will have some obstructions. So what you will have to do is you have to sort of glue into this representation another representation, V mu, with the highest weight, which will be not greater than lambda. And then you have to glue a bunch of others. And there's a strangely looking picture, which sort of resembles some kind of cellular structure. And this structure is completely absent in the undeformed case. And as I said, well, add, yes. I mean, say, if you think about this as vector spaces, you just add more vector spaces. But say, if you are trying to think about this in terms of geometrical quantization, you want to represent this as some sections of some modules over some orbits. So then this would mean that say the orbits of loop groups, the corresponding underlying symplectic manifolds, they would have this strange stratification. I don't know what it would mean. So there are these problems, and now let me give the answer for the representation ring. Again, I don't want to explain how, but one can define the analog of the local completion of UQG hat, similarly to to what Frankel and Fagan did for universal Hamiltonian algebra of G hat. And theorem one is the following. If you will take the center of the quantized universal Hamiltonian algebra at any level, it will be isomorphic to the center of quantized finite dimensional algebra. However, if you will take the local completion, now I did a mistake here. So if k is not equal to h dual, you still will have the same finitely generated center. But if k is equal to h dual, if it's a critical level, then the algebra again is infinitely generated. And now we have the sort of problem how to describe this center. Fortunately, more or less the same construction as I explained for the finite dimensional case. It works for this affine case. One can construct again these elements ZV, which will give essentially an isomorphism between the description number one, algebraic description. This is the same as the ring of isomorphism classes of finite dimensional representations of UQ G hat. This doesn't say much because we don't know anything about this ring so far. So we better have some other description. And this is so the other description came from the the other description comes from the Poisson geometry. First, algebraical point of view on this Poisson geometry. So again, we want to consider this center as a Poisson algebra for the same reasons, because we have a family, we have jump of the center at a certain point. At this point, we have the Poisson structure in this center. So this conjectural description is a theorem for classical. It's a theorem for SLN. It's a theorem for rank two cases, and it's almost theorem for the rest of the cases. We are still working on this with Edward Frankel. And the idea is the following. Consider this very explicit algebra. It's kind of Q analog of the Heisenberg algebra, Poisson-Heisenberg algebra. And consider this very special elements. Unfortunately, I have no time to explain why it's reasonable to consider these elements. And consider these special elements Si. They are known in many incarnations, sort of in physics and mathematics. One of them is so-called screening operators in conformal field theory, and the other meaning of these elements is that they are actually infinitesimal generators of some group, important group action. And here's the conjecture. This center considered as a Poisson algebra is the following. It's a Poisson centralizer of these elements Si in this Poisson algebra. So you just consider all elements of this Poisson algebra that commutes with this, that, which, whose Poisson bracket with these special elements Si is zero. And so this will give a homomorphism of algebras. And second, that this is almost an isomorphism. Almost an isomorphism meaning that if you will consider the variety which is the specter, the infinite dimensional variety which is the specter of this commutative algebra, and compare it with the variety, consider how it's sitting inside of this, of the spectrum of the center, then this maps of the spectrum of this to the spectrum of the center gives the open dense subset in the spectrum of the center. So now more geometric description is the difference analog of this Drinfeld-Sokolov reduction, which I explained earlier, but I think I didn't name it this way. So this is really the end. This is the last transparency. So so let me just fix notation. So now G is complex, simple, algebraic Lie group. Loops in G corresponding, better to think about this in formal loop groups. So just Laurent power series in Z, these coefficients in G. H is Cartan subgroup. U is just upper triangular matrices with the identity, with the units in the diagonal. And W is the Weyl group. S1 is L are simple reflections in the Weyl group. N1 and L are the lifts in the complex algebraic Lie group G. And now let's define this element M, which is the following. You take upper unipotent subgroup, take the product of these elements, which is essentially the Coxeter element in the Weyl group, and multiply it to V. So this will give you some subvariety in G. And this is the nonlinear version of this of this matrices with the identities just below diagonal, which were which I used before. Now this loop group LG acts on itself by the so-called Q gauge transformations, where Q is some non-zero complex number, and this action descends. That's a theorem that it descends to the action of the corresponding loop group. And the conjecture is that, which again is proven for SLN, and which is soon to be proven for the other cases, is that the spectrum of the local completion, of the center of the local completion at the critical level, is the same as LU invariant functions on. On this space, and it's a very strange description, and which is more or less entirely due to the existence of the Poisson structure. And well, again, you can think about this part. I mean, you can think about this part of the theorem as the analog of the quantum finite dimensional part, and you can think about this part of the theorem as the analog of this. Infinite dimensional Harishchandra isomorphism. Well, there are three papers. I didn't get even close to any of the details of this. So there are three papers by Edward Frenkel and me, and one of them is Frenkel, Semenov, Nishensky, and me. And here, I mean, most of the results are taken from these papers.
Thank you.
Okay.
Any questions?
So if you look at the center at non-critical level, the quantum, so you said that by what you said it's isomorphic to the representation rate of finite dimensional quantum.
Yes. Yes, roughly speaking, this happens because, say, if you consider highest weight modules, they are parameterized by the highest weight for the finite dimensional Lie group, Lie algebra G, and by the level. So at given level, highest irreducible highest weight modules, they are parameterized by the highest weights. And there are, roughly speaking, n numbers here when n is drunk. So this is the
center. Sort of the traces corresponding to these ones.
They are elements of the center only at the critical level. They are not central at non-critical level. That's, I mean, there are just some elements which would be interesting to understand what's the meaning of those elements, but they, I mean, so far they don't have any meaning outside of the critical domain.
I have a question.
It would be, it's a very natural question. I don't know the answer to this question. What we have here is the following. There are some elements, this Z, say, omega I. Well, Z I, they actually depend on t, well, which correspond to fundamental representations. And some kind of miracle which doesn't have quite yet reasonable explanation is that if you will take this the Poisson brackets of this, it will, the result will have sort of two terms, some kind of regular terms which would include only the I's themselves plus some singular terms including some delta, formal delta functions and their derivatives, which would include sort of other terms from the universal developing algebra. So this structure of the Poisson bracket suggests that there might be some purely representation theoretical meaning for this derivation of this structure, but
what happens?
Well, here Q is generic. If Q is, say, is a root of unity, then the center is even bigger. And strictly speaking, there you have two Poisson structures coming from sort of two different sources. One is coming from specialization of the central element at this critical value. And at the root of one, the other will come from specialization of Q to the root of one. So you have two compatible Poisson structures.
You mean compatible, they commute?
They commute.
Any other